Hello everyone. Today we are going to see about some kind of research work that is going on in the area of smart grids. Since this is just an introductory course on introduction to smart grid, so we'd like to see as a part of since almost we are coming towards the end of this. I think today is lecture 8. So we will see some basic understanding, basic areas of research in what is a smart grid. And the process is called literature survey. So we'll look at some research articles. See, in the earlier sessions of this particular course, we were looking at some articles such as, some IEEE, not IEEE, the ISGF newsletters and bulletins and things like that. But now we'll go a little bit into technical literature. So one example like that is IEEE. So there is, I'll just quickly make a list. So IEEE. Transactions in smart grid. So let's begin our search with this particular thing. So what I do is just go to Google and then I'm just typing IEEE Explore Digital Library, and you get this result and go to this IEEE Explore. Now, either you can search with respect to topic or you can search with respect to a particular journal. So directly I'll just type here smart grid. So when I search like this, a lot of results have come. Now, publications you may be interested in. So this is some, looks like a new feature. So there is a publications you may be interested in thing, and already some suggestions are there. So let's go to the first one. That's what I was just mentioning. So here we are getting the home page of IEEE transactions on smart grid. So this is one of the sources. This is not the only one. There are several, literally hundreds of journals. But then I am just going through some of the what you call more well-known ones. So here we have home and then popular, early access, current issue, all issues and about this journal. So now if I just look at the statement here, IEEE transaction smart grid is a cross-disciplinary and internationally archival journal aimed at disseminating results of research on smart grid that relates to, arises from or deliberately influences energy generation, transmission, distribution, and delivery. So energy transmission, distribution, and generation and delivery, all these sectors, it is there. So this is like a one of the this thing. Now, if I go to current issue, first let's go to all issues. So when you go to all issues, so here at the top, we can see 2010, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So apparently this particular journal has started in 2010. So there are some journals which keep starting from, much earlier than that, but looks like this journal started in 10. And then it's called volume. Okay? So volume means it's kind of serial number. So every year it will be, say for example, 2010 will be volume 1, 2011 will be volume 2, volume 3, volume 4, like that. So under volume 11, that is 2020, there's a volume 11, there are 5 issues. Okay? Now if I select 2019, down it is showing to volume 10 and there are 6 issues. So apparently every year it has 6 issues. So there are 10 volumes and 6 issues. The 11 volume up to 2020. So now now issue 6 is about to come. Obviously it means that. And every 2 months one issue will come. That again I can deduce because this particular journal having 6 issues per year, that means every 2 months they are going to. So what this particular journal does is all over the world, people submit their research work on smart grids, and every 2 months there will be, of course, there will be a very stringent review process. Most of the papers may get rejected because they are not interesting, or they are not well written, or they are not useful for the general community. And finally, it will be there. Okay. So now, before I move forward, let me again ask somebody from the audience. So please suggest any one year and any one issue, and we'll explore that particular year and issue. Okay. So yeah, so anybody can suggest.
Sir, say this year only will go, sir. See, issue 2.
Okay, so 2020 issue 2. So randomly, one of the student has suggested issue 2. So here, now when I open issue 2, March 2020, so here download PDF and all is there per page 25. So instead of this, I keep 100 articles per page so that I get everything in one list. And there are 89. Okay, so there are about 89 articles in this, so including table of contents and things like that. So approximately, even if you take lower number, 80 articles per issue. So let's make a quick calculation. So I open a calculator, and then so I'll just right away search it here. So let's say 80 articles per issue multiplied by 6 articles, sorry, 6 issues per year, and multiplied by 11 years. So that is since it's starting. So now if I see this, the number comes to around 5,280. Okay? This is only IEEE transactions in smart grid approximately. So even if you take, instead of 80, only 50 articles, even if you take less one, at least 3,000 articles, 3,300 articles are there. Okay, so good. So we have good number of articles to worry about. So therefore, obviously, one person cannot read all these articles. So it has to be a group effort. So let us just quickly browse through some of these. Okay, so I hope you are able to see the titles. Let me increase the magnification so that you are able to see the titles properly. So this is volume 11, issue 2. By the way, those who have access to IEEE through their institute or through their personal account, this key symbol, lock symbol, will be open. But those who don't have access, this will be locked. But then at least you can see the title, and you can see at least the abstract of the paper, okay? Even if you don't have any listing. So wide area robust sliding mode controller for power system with false data injection attacks. So what is this talking about? Some false data injection attacks. So this is something related to cyber security. Next one also, cyber physical security analytics for transactive energy system. So some time back, one of the student was talking about, you know, what about the issue of cyber security? Yes, that is an issue, and there is research going on to address that. So two-layer distributed cooperative control method for islanded network microgrid system. So how to control islanded networked microgrid? So and a two-layer control. This is one more. So malicious corruption resilience in PMU data while wide area damping control. So again, somebody may corrupt the data, and how do you save from it? So these are some of the research articles, right? So hierarchical distributed voltage optimization methods for HV and MV distribution network. So this is another. So I'm not reading. I'll just simply scroll through. You can have a look at it. Now, will it be very easy to follow? Of course, it will not be easy to follow because these are research publications, and after doing at least 1-2 years of research, they will be able to write these papers. So it, at first reading, definitely people from, you know, UG level or even PG level may not be able to understand everything properly, but at least you will understand what are the issues, what is the area. So a rolling optimization of mobile energy storage fleets for resilient service restoration. So what do you What do you understand from this? So let's try to decode. So service restoration. What is a service restoration? If there is any fault and there is a power interruption, how to restore your service? So that access, that property is called, that activity is called service restoration. And how we are doing service restoration? Mobile energy storage fleet. Okay, that means you, what is a mobile energy storage? That means there is a truck. Inside, the batteries will be there in the truck, and the energy will be stored in the batteries. And they are mobile, and not one truck, there is a fleet of trucks, multiple trucks. So the distribution company is maintaining trucks filled with batteries, storing energy in them. Wherever there is a interruption, immediately they will mobile. I mean, they will drive the truck to that location, and through the energy stored in the batteries, they will supply the power. Meanwhile, whatever repairs are needs to be done and all that is done, and then the power will be restored, and then again the truck will come back, and then it will again get charged or whatever. Now, in doing all these things, some kind of optimization is required. So this paper deals with that, at least. So that is the understanding which I got from the title. So are you able to get the concept from reading the titles of the paper? Anybody having any questions or doubts, feel free to stop me. Now here you can see intelligent multi-microgrid energy management based on deep neural network and model-free reinforcement learning. So this is again an example where artificial intelligence and analytics and things like that, neural networks and all. So those things are coming into application for microgrid energy management. So this is again another. Data-driven probabilistic optimal power flow with non-parametric Bayesian modeling interface. So this is another. So like this, you can see. So this is multi-agent service restoration for distribution network with DGs. So virtual energy storage sharing and capacity allocation. So this is like a nice short title, but again, see, depends on different people's interest. They may get attracted to certain papers, and certain papers may seem too high level or too technical, and so on. So, but then this one, I think it is interesting. That is virtual energy storage sharing. So, can anybody explain what you understand by this title, energy storage sharing? So can anybody explain what you understood by this title? Yeah, feel free to make an attempt. So what is storage sharing? So obviously storage sharing. So you can compare it with ride sharing. So if you see Uber or Ola kind of cab sharing technologies, where you have a vehicle and you have empty seats and you are going in a certain direction, so you can sell those empty seats in your car, and then you are sharing your ride. So similarly, energy storage sharing. What do you understand from that? So again, storage sharing is you have some battery in your house, but for 1 week you are not staying in your house, but your battery is still there. So anyway, the battery is going to be idle because you are away from your house. But meanwhile, when you are not in house, you can use your battery to transact with the grid. Certain times you store the energy from the grid, and certain times you sell the energy back to the grid using your battery. You may be in a different city, different place, and remotely you can control your battery, or you can even automatically program your battery so that by the time you end your vacation, come back to your house, your battery system might have earned some money for you by trading with the grid. So because the grid prices keeps on changing, so at certain times grid want power, so you can do that. So this is virtual energy storage sharing. And capacity allocation, that might be allocating the capacity. That is how much capacity to whom you want to allocate and so on. Now, if you click on this abstract, you can see something like this. So a little bit more description. So if you are not able to understand just by the title, you can just go through this abstract, and you can do that. So energy storage can play important role in energy management of end users. To promote an efficient utilization of energy storage, we develop novel business model to enable virtual storage sharing among the groups of users. So the users are forming groups, and they are sharing the storage. So just like you're sharing resources with your neighbors, so you can now share the energy storage. A storage aggregator invests and operates the central physical storage unit by virtualizing it into separable virtual capacities and selling to users. So here again, a little bit more idea is coming in this picture. So let's say there are 10 houses. Nobody have any storage with them. So a storage aggregator can invest in a large battery. And let's say the large battery storage is about 1 megawatt hour or something like that. That particular capacity, he can sell to individual houses. So instead of you buying an individual battery in your house, you buy a share in a bigger battery that is installed at the community level. So what is the business model? How to show the costing and et cetera? All that things is explained in this particular paper, which came in issue 2 of 2020. So again, if you further go into the paper, maybe I'll just show example. So since the place where I am, I have direct access to IEEE articles, so I can open this particular article, and also I can show that. So this is again the title, and the authors are there, and this is the abstract again. So the same abstract that we saw sometime back, the same it is there. So each user purchases virtual capacity and utilize to reduce the energy cost. So interaction between aggregator and users as a two-stage optimization. So like this, some kind of optimization. And finally, let's see in our simulation results. Let's look at this example. I'm sorry. So in our simulation results, the proposed storage virtualization model can reduce the physical energy storage investment of the aggregator by 54% and reduce the user's total cost by 34% compared to the case where users acquire their own physical storage. So this is huge, actually. This, the 50% reduction in the investment, and that is for the aggregator, and 34% reduction in the total cost for the users. So it is a very useful and interesting concept. So again, those who want to further go into this, they can go into going through this paper. And obviously, the first reading you might understand there might be a lot of mathematics involved in it, but as you gradually try to make an attempt, you know, on multiple readings, definitely you will be able to make some sense. If not the complete algorithm, at least you'll be able to understand the kind of, you know, the case studies and results and things like that. So this is the this is how a kind of research paper looks like. Now let's go back to this list again. Steady state simulation, combined transmission and distribution, so optimal power scheduling. Market framework for decentralized congestion management in smart distribution grids, considering collaboration among electric vehicle aggregators. So this is again a problem of congestion. Okay, what is this congestion? So if there is a distribution network, it is like any network. It is a road network kind of thing, or any supply network. The distribution network itself can have congestion at certain places. Congestion is overloading. So how to use electric vehicle aggregators to reduce that? So this is again one more interesting. So many articles are like this in this. So data-driven approach for targeting residential customers for energy efficiency programs. Okay, so now you have an energy efficiency program and you want to identify who is the right customer to adopt this particular energy efficiency program. So again, you can use this. So let's again go through the aspect of this. Targeting the right customers for energy efficiency program is crucial for power distribution retail companies to enhance the efficiency of the marketing budget allocation and yield of the energy savings. So this works presents a scalable methodology for targeting residential customers for energy efficiency programs that focus on reducing unnecessary domestic energy consumption. So replacing low and efficient equipment with new equipment and so on. So like that. So this is again energy peer-to-peer trading in virtual microgrids and smart grids, a game theoretic approach. Stealth attack on the smart grid. So this is a mixture of all these things. So if you notice the kind of articles that are there, some are purely electrical in nature. They're talking about power flow study, stability and things like that. Some are cyber physical, cyber attacks and that kind of area. Some are overlapping with artificial intelligence applications and things like that. And some are into economics, what is the market model, what is the business model, and things like that. So for example, reconfigurable distribution networks for managing transactive energy in a multi-microgrid system. Towards distributed energy services, decentralizing optimal power flow with machine learning. So there are so many interdisciplinary areas that are involved in this. So as I mentioned, there are, I'm just going really fast now. So there are almost about 89 articles in this particular issue. So grid influenced peer-to-peer energy trading and so on. So again, this is related to trading. Transfer learning, so this is again machine learning application. So arithmetic method with mixed the triangular domain. So this looks like some highly mathematical paper. So again, attack scheme for feeder automation. So these are the kind of papers that are there in this. So if once you get into implementation, so many issues comes into picture, and all of this research work is trying to address those issues. So at this stage, I'll just simply pause for a while. So any questions, any points that you want to add here? So here again, you can see one more. Deep reinforcement learning for EV charging navigation by coordinating smart grid and intelligent transportation system. So there is actually this ITS topic is there. There are actually separate journals for ITS, intelligent transportation system. And usually people from transportation engineering, civil engineering background. So those people will be doing research in that particular topic. So now, what now they are saying is how a smart grid and intelligent transportation system can coordinate with each other. So usually civil engineering people and electrical engineering people, they don't do joint research. But here is one example where smart grid and ITS can coordinate with each other. So if you see the practical problems of the world, they don't come on department-wise, or a particular domain or faculty-wise. So these problems are kind of general, and it may require interdisciplinary research to address this problem. So this is one example. Let's just read it. So coordinated operation of smart grid and intelligent transportation system provide electric vehicle owners with myriad of power and transportation network data for EV charging navigation. Optimal charging navigation would be challenging task owing to randomness of traffic conditions, charging prices, and waiting time at EV charging station. So, I mean, there's still some more is there, but at least the problems are known here. So the problems are randomness in traffic and charging prices and waiting time. So I think this particular paper presents some kind of model to address these problems. So basically, the point I'm trying to make is that the subject is like an ocean. The more deeper you go, the more interesting problems will come into existence, and then you will have to kind of identify where you want to go into. So dummy data attacks in power system, this is another issue. Short-term reactive power planning to minimize cost of energy loss considering PV system. So it's kind of some discussion it is there. So this is about some one particular what you call issue. That is issue 2 and March 2020. So like this. So, would you like to look at any other journal apart from this IEEE transactions in smart grid? So, we roughly calculated at least 3,000 to 5,000 papers are there in IEEE transactions on smart grid. Okay? That much of research output all over the world is there in this particular subject. So, let me now go for another thing. So there is one more journal which is also kind of well known. That is Electric Power System Research, EPSR journal. So let's look at this. So view articles. So here also, this is Science Direct. This is different from IEEE. It's a different thing. So let's look at all issues. So there was a link for all issues. So there is volume 190. So volume 190. So usually we associate volume with year, but in this case it is not. See, in the year 2020, 178 to 189 volumes. So about 11 volumes have come. So I think this is like what you call monthly one journal will come in this, I believe. Because what is it? 166 to 177. So about again 11. Yeah. So approximately about 11 volumes per year we are getting. So if you see from 2002, it is there. If I go a little older, so 1982, it is there. If I go even older, so volume one happened in 1977. So this is the history. So this EPSR, Electric Power System Research, started its this journal started way back in 1977, and from there, you know, volume one, volume two, like this slowly it started. Let me see if we can see something, you know, whether there is something is there in this. Yes, so we got some results. So okay, so research article, losses in electrical power system. Okay, so let's just, I mean, looking at 2020 papers is different. Looking at 1977, so at that time, the computers were just entering into power sector. In fact, the adoption of computers in power sector is very, very slow compared to any other like banking sector or telecom sector or retail sector. So computerization of power sector happened very, very late. So we can see some interesting, you know, papers that time also. Current limiting to distribution current, damper vibration attenuation. So this is a little bit more into power. and I think there were little less articles in it. Okay, now let me go back. So let's come to one of the latest years. So maybe I'll come to the 2020. So let's say volume 188. So I'm just trying to see how many articles are there. So there's no total displayed anywhere, but anyway, at least I can roughly see there are at least 50 articles in this also. Okay, so again, if you see, even if you take again from 2000, so 20 years, so 20 years, that is from 2000, 50 articles per this thing, and about 11 articles per month. So the total now comes to 11,000 articles. So thousands of articles are available, research level articles. These are not into textbooks. These are not into the regular things. But then these are some of the what you call research articles. So let me just see. So here you can see a planning framework for AC/DC. Planning framework for AC/DC bilayer microgrid. So optimal volt wear control. You know, this is another this thing. So like this, there are so many. So what I suggest is you spend some time, explore some of these research articles, and then try to find a little bit, read you know, article details, and just like how you are browsing any news items, you can just go through this, and you can try to gain some things. At least what kind of problems are there inside this? Now I would like to, before we what you call search for any other journal, I'd like to come back to IEEE Explore, and I want to show something called this advanced search. So when you do this advanced search, so you can do a little bit more. Instead of a specific journal, you can see in general every all the types of journals. Now here it is saying search term and another search term and another search term. So there are multiple search terms are So we can let's start with smart grid as one search term, and electric vehicle as another search term, and let's say markets as another search term. Okay. So then now if I search like this, so we'll get some results. Okay. So there are only just 10 issues, that is which is having smart grid and electric vehicles and markets. Okay. So like this. So let's see what these are. So this is 2013 article. So electric vehicle potential in Australia, it impact on smart grid. So very interesting title. So what is the potential in Australia and its impact on smart grid? So this might be something interesting. Now you can change the country name in whichever country you are. You can insert that country, and that becomes a kind of topic. You know, electric vehicle potential in India, for example. I am from India, and its impact on smart grids. So it's a so you can see what kind of format, what kind of flow, what kind of structure these people are using for doing the research, and we can adopt that, and then with the data of your respective country, you can do a similar kind of research. So let's just see if there are any numbers here. Let's see. So Australia has very large market for electric vehicles. There are well-known advantages like zero direct emission, reduced dependency on oil, cheaper fuel, all these things. EVs can also offer unique benefit called vehicle-to-grid technology. So what is this vehicle-to-grid technology? So vehicle-to-grid technology is where the power flow direction is from the vehicle towards the grid. So normally electric vehicle means what we think, the power is flowing from grid towards the electric vehicle, and then the electric vehicle starts driving and then consuming that power. But here there is also another concept that is V2G, vehicle to grid. So through V2G technology, EVs can support better operation of smart grid in terms of reliability and storage. Based on reliable statistics and social studies, this article studies the EV potential of Australia and envisages the impact of large EV utilization therein. So basically, the point is, with the vehicle to grid technology, the EVs will become even more attractive. So that is the point. Anyway, let's go back. So my point was, you can do this advanced search and specifically find papers related to particular topic. So direct load management of electric vehicles, how the electric vehicles load management can be there. Cybersecurity issues, assessment framework for plug-in electric vehicle strategies. So some are 2010 papers, some are 2015 papers, and some are new papers. Joint energy management and energy trading in residential microgrid system. So there will be, of course, electric vehicles inside because it is coming as the this thing. Efficient energy delivery management for plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. So this is another topic. So I hope you got some idea. Okay? So how to use this advanced search. So I would like to conclude maybe next 5 to 10 minutes. So any doubts, any questions anybody want to ask at this stage, feel free to ask. Yeah, so any questions, anyone? Okay, so if you have no further questions, then I'll try to conclude here. See, the point of today's session was just to sensitize you. I'm sorry, we got one very good question. Who decides whether a paper is good enough to be published? So So again, I'm opening this transactions in Smart Grid Journal. So the question one of the students is asking, who decides whether the paper is good enough or not? So I'm just opening the home page and about this journal. So here you can see Meet the Editor. So there is an editor in chief, Claudio Canizares. So who is from University of Waterloo in Ontario, Canada. So this particular person is the editor in chief, but editor in chief is not the person who actually decides. The person who actually decides are the reviewers. So when you submit the paper to this particular journal, first it goes to the editor, then the editor will assign the paper for reviewing to some experts, three or four experts. and they again review and they give their comments. And then the paper is good, they will say the paper is good. If the paper is bad, they will say paper should be rejected. So a lot of times, like the selection is quite difficult. You will have to convince the reviewers. Reviewers will ask you to revise and resubmit the paper. Then again, you revise and resubmit. So and so on like that. So let me go back. So I'll also want to show one example. So I'm just opening one. Okay, anyway, this was anyway already opened. So let's look at it. See, here you can see usually as a what you call footnote, it will be written manuscript received September 22 and revised January 5 and April 13 and accepted in June 30. So and date of publication is July 30. So the first time the manuscript was submitted is in the September of 2018, and by the time it is published, it has become July of 2019. So almost how many months? So 7 months in 2019 and September, October, November, December. So almost about 11, 10 to 11 months it has taken for this particular paper from the submission to final publication. So there will be first revision in January, again one more revision in April, and finally it got accepted. This paper got revised two times. So first the author submitted the paper, reviewers did not like it. They gave some comments. Of course, if they did not completely like it, they will right away reject it. But they said, okay, some corrections are needed, some changes are needed. Then the author did some work, again resubmitted. Again, the reviewer said that no, not good enough. Again, make some more changes. So again, it got changed, and finally, it got accepted in June of 2019. So this is the review process. So the another paper. This is another paper, cyber attack related. So let's see what is the history of this. So first received August 12, 2019, revised in November, accepted in March, and then date of publication is March. So and so on like this. So again, it took about again 10 to 11 months for this. So anyway, so I think I hope that answers your question. Any other question you have? That was a good question. Where were we? Yeah, so anything, yeah. Any question anybody else has? Okay, so if there are no further questions, I think I'll end the session here a little bit early because I have one more session later, so I would like to end this here. Okay, thank you.